are not enough to get us into paradise without the mercy in which the Prophet ﷺ said that anyone who says, the Prophet ﷺ said, all of your sins will be forgiven. This is the purpose of our creation, is to worship God. But that isn't what gets us into paradise by itself. It isn't enough. In other words, our deeds are necessary, but not sufficient. They are not enough to get us into paradise without the mercy and forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hadith in which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that anyone who says subhanallah wa bihamdi 100 times, so the amount of time that that takes is probably just like a few minutes. Subhanallah wa bihamdi. That just saying that statement 100 times, the Prophet ﷺ said, all of your sins will be forgiven. Even if they were like as much as the foam on the ocean. So imagine, you know, anyone who's seen the ocean, at the top of the ocean, there's like this foam. It's like these, almost these like, this like these bubbles right at the top of the ocean. And imagine that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, now think about the entire ocean, not just the part on the beach that you can see, but the entire ocean. If your sins were like that foam on the entire ocean, just saying subhanallah wa bihamdi 100 times would have all your sins forgiven. This is just one example of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that how he gives us actions that are simple for us to do, but are extremely heavy with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In another hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that there is an action that is light on the tongue, heavy on the scale, and beloved to Ar-Rahman. So this action that is heavy on the that is light on the tongue, heavy on the scale, and beloved to Ar-Rahman is saying subhanallah wa bihamdi subhanallah al-azim. So again, that same statement. Now I want to take a moment and translate the statement and maybe just quickly sort of reflect on the meaning and the heaviness of the statement, but I wanted to give these two references just to show how important just this statement is to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, subhanallah, the first part, subhanallah. So this is something that we hear a lot, something we may say a lot, especially when we experience something amazing, right? But what does it actually linguistically mean? So subhanallah, the first part of it, subhana, actually comes from the root in the Arabic language that is to swim or to float. And the reason why subhanallah means what it means is because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is high above, he is elevated from any imperfection, from anything that you associate with him, from anything that is inappropriate to his greatness. So when you say subhanallah, it's that Allah is exalted. Because when you think about, if you look at the literal meaning, if you think about when you're swimming, you basically on the top of the water, right? You're typically floating on top of the water. And so what it is linguistically, literally saying is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is on top of, he is elevated above, he is glorified above any imperfection or any statement that associates partners with him. This is why you'll see that in the Quran, the way in which subhanallah is used is typically it's associated with someone or any kind of statement that contradicts his tawheed, contradicts tawheed. So anyone, for example, who when it talks about those who associate partners with Allah, those who say that Allah has a son, those who say that Allah has daughters, you know, all these various blasphemous statements that Allah is high above, that Allah is exalted above, that Allah is glorified above. When you say subhanallah, so you say, for example, you'll see in the Quran, subhanallah amma yushrikun, that Allah is high above, that Allah is exalted above anything that they associate with him. So this is the meaning of subhanallah. وَبِحَمْدِهِ, the second part, is the praise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hamd is to praise. And hamd is interesting because it actually denotes the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most worthy of praise, regardless of whether or not any of his creation praise him. So the hamd, the fact that he is worthy of all the praise, is independent of whether or not we actually acknowledge that. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not dependent upon his creation acknowledging his greatness. Allah is just great. Allah is most worthy of praise because of his greatness, independent of whether or not it is recognized by his creation.